This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Max Milo Editions present Left for Dead by Nadia Kaci. On July 13, 2001, in Hassi Messaoud, an oil-rich town in southern Algeria, following virulent preaching by the imam, about 500 men assaulted and tortured some 50 women during a raid to inflict punishment. Public humiliation, family scorn, silence from the foreign press, and fear of reprisals followed this nightmarish experience, which most of the victims chose to forget. But some women refused to forget, and demanded that the culprits face punishment. Rahmouna Salah and Fatiha Maamoura fought right up to the trial. From their childhood in patriarchal families, through marriages, renunciations and divorces, to the birth of their children, these women tell of the difficulties of living outside the yoke of men in a society undergoing terrible upheavals. Nadia Kaci is an actress, playing in Bertrand Tavernier's film 1998, Viva, Laldjérie and Delhi's Paloma by Nadir Moknèche, 2004 and 2006. She was the co-writer for both Rahmouna Salah and Fatiha Maamoura. Rahmouna Salah and Fatiha Maamoura were born and raised in Algeria. With this courageous testimony, they continue their fight. Notes are available on electronic and paper editions of the book. Friday, July 13, 2001. 300 to 500 men passed on the message. The punitive expedition ordered by the Imam of El Hacha would take place tonight. The day before, at the mosque, he had finally given them the green light. For a long time now, he had been pointing an accusing finger at these fornicators, carriers of AIDS and other diseases. They were taking the work of simple, modest men. They were arousing their sinful urges by strutting naked, without hijabs, all over town. They were soiling the reputation of their humble neighborhoods, and they were drawing the wrath of Allah. We had to crack down, teach them a lesson. Show these whores their place, their only place. The one demanded by their sex. Wanted by tradition. Ordered by Allah. We had to be fierce to finally get them to respect their rank and play their roles. You must purify every street in our city. Allah is with you. Holy war in the name of God, he proclaimed before retreating. The men decided to purify the three main districts of their city. The 200 housing district, the 136 housing district and El Hacha, officially named Buamama. It was in the latter neighborhood that there were the most women. They met at the entrance to the 200. Armed with clubs, sticks, knives or sabers. Armed with all the hatred they'd been inculcated with for these women. Determined to prove to them, to themselves, their supremacy. Determined to take revenge for all the frustrations their mere presence aroused and fueled. Allahu Akbar. El Jihad fi sabil Allah. God is great. Holy war in the name of God. That was the signal for departure. With their blood boiling, they threw flaming tires into the middle of the road to prevent anyone from coming to the women's aid. In the distance, a man waved a grey shirt in his hand. He was calling to them. Like hungry wolves, they pounced on their first victim. Chapter 1. Childhood at the foot of the hill. My name is Rahmouna Salah. I was born on July 12, 1966 in Oran. We were seven children. Five girls and two boys. The eldest, my sister Baya, was 9 years older than me. She was like a little mother to us. My brother Yusef was 2 years younger. He didn't talk to me much, but whenever my father wasn't around, he often beat me. My sisters Khadija, Fatima and Nafisa were 5, 4 and 2 years younger than me. Discreet and submissive, they obeyed Yusef and never contradicted him. But my favorite was my brother Abdulik, 2 years my senior. My lifelong accomplice. My father was a horse dealer and co-owner of a slaughterhouse. He was a handsome man, quite tall. His fair complexion earned him the nickname Erugi, meaning ginger, even though he didn't have a single red hair on his head. Zahouani, a notorious partygoer, he adored music and Chaikits, the renowned Rai singers of Western Algeria. We lived in a pleasant little house next to my paternal grandparents, on a quiet street at the foot of a hill. We only saw my father 2 or 3 days a week. The rest of his time was divided between his 2 other wives, of whose existence we children were unaware, and parties. But despite his absences, he made sure we never lacked for anything. When he went out, he liked one of his daughters to accompany him, as long as she wasn't over prepubescent age. When she did, she was replaced by a younger girl. I loved it when he took me to see his friends, especially the women. I thought they were pretty. I remember one of them, who must have been a nurse. We used to visit her in hospital. She wore a beautiful white blouse that highlighted the sparkle of her teeth. She laughed loudly and teased my father a lot. They joked all the time. It amused me enormously. My innocent eyes couldn't understand the true nature of their relationship. But she was probably one of my father's other 2 wives. And then there were those nighttime jaunts out into the middle of nowhere. On the occasion of a wedding or christening, my father and his friends would get together. I was the only child. We were lit by a huge wood fire around which sheikhs and sheikhettes sang, accompanied by a gasba, a wooden flute and a bendir. Dancers swayed to the rhythm of the music. My father forbade me to wander off. I'd fall asleep right next to him, a few meters from the fire, surrounded by the joyful sounds. I liked that. I didn't like accompanying him to the slaughterhouse. The smell of blood turned my stomach. And those animals we were going to kill, I always refused to go near them. Frozen with fear, I could hear them on the other side of the wall, bellowing their death throes. I've always hated beef. I loved my father more than anything. My mother didn't like me following him around. She thought he was too permissive with his daughters. He was always saying, "They'll do what they want. They'll go to school if they feel like it. They will marry the man of their choice." For her part, she grumbled all day long. "It's your father who will lose you. Follow your father and you'll see, he'll lead you to your ruin. If you dishonor me, you're no longer my daughter. If you embarrass me, I'll suck your blood." She never sucked anyone's blood. But her little phrases were painful to hear, even if I didn't understand them all. I felt that they were full of possible hatred. I was less attached to Ma because she wasn't very patient with us. In her defense, she was very tired. Most of the time she was pregnant, and her pregnancies were always difficult. As for childbirth, it was particularly painful for her. She lost a lot of blood. Sometimes her babies. 7 died at birth or in infancy. I remember one of my brothers, Mahmoud, tiny, agonizing in his bed, his belly swollen. I watched him go, helpless and sad to see Ma cry. My brothers also hit me. On the pretext that I didn't eat at the same time as everyone else, that I was too cheeky, that I talked back, or because I had disobeyed my mother, preferring to go for a walk with my father. I think they were jealous. My father would never ask one of his sons to join him. So they beat me. When Dad came back, I'd complain. He'd hit them, and then when Dad left, my brothers would hit me again, because I'd complain to my father. However, I never resented my brother Abdulik for very long. After all, when I wasn't feeling well, only he would notice. What's more, he was my only playmate. We shared the same room and were inseparable. When he caught pneumonia at the age of 8, I caught it too. The illness isolated us from the rest of the family. We were hospitalized for 3 months. When we got out, we were told we'd missed the start of the school year. It was heartbreaking for me, I'd been looking forward to it so much. My father decided to enroll us both in a private school, 8 kilometers from our home. His driver drove us in the morning and picked us up at the end of the day. One day, my father gave us a sumptuous gift. A little red car that we could both ride in. We'd pull it up to the top of the hill. And race down the street laughing like mad. We never wanted to leave it. So much so that one morning, as the driver was waiting to take us to school, my brother asked me, "Go see Dad. He'll listen to you. Tell him you're sick. Then we can stay home and play with our car." I agreed because I liked the idea so much. But my father wasn't fooled. "You're not sick," he said. "Here's some change. Buy yourself some candy and run off to school." "But Dad, they'll steal the car if we leave it here." "I'll put it on the terrace. Scram. I'm really sick. I don't want to go." My father grabbed me violently between his strong arms and threw me to the sidewalk. I leapt to my feet, shouting, "I'm healed, Daddy. I'm healed. I'm going to school." That was the only time he hit me, but I was sore for 3 days. On another occasion, we found a baby bird that had fallen from its nest. It looked very fragile, but it was alive. My brother said to me, "If we don't take him with us, he'll die. Put it in your school bag. We'll make him a little nest with our socks. That way, he'll make it all the way home. There, we'll take care of him until he grows up." I refused. Our mistress was far too strict, and I didn't dare imagine her reaction and the punishment that would follow if she discovered the animal. "If she sees it, I'll explain that I put it in your school bag," my brother assured me. Shortly after arriving at the classroom, little plaintive cries escaped from my bag and propelled the teacher straight at me. Her wooden ruler, which never left her side, persuaded me quickly enough. It was my brother's idea to put this little bird in my school bag. I had nothing to do with it. "I didn't even know the baby bird was in his school bag," Abdulik retorted without batting an eyelid. "I should have known, as with the cakes he'd sent me to steal from my mother's dresser, he denied everything without scruple. I received 10 blows on my fingers. When I got out of school, mad with rage, I grabbed a big rock and hit my brother on the head. I hit him once. There was a lot of blood. But the next day, we were back to being the best of friends." Chapter 2. Tata Zaki. Aunt Zakir didn't live very far from the school. So at lunchtime, when it was cold, we would go and have lunch at her house. This meant we didn't have to waste time traveling home. And we could play with her son, who was about our age. Ma said it calmed her down to know we were at Aunt Zakir's. Aunt Zakir wasn't really our aunt. But since my maternal uncle was keen to marry her, she was already part of the family. Except that she was already married. She had made the pilgrimage to Mecca, which earned her the honorary title of Hajjah. She wasn't very pretty, but she had charisma and glibness. She also had beautiful jewelry and lots of gold teeth. She owned a herd of sheep and oxen, and had gone into business with my maternal uncles to increase her capital. She came to visit us regularly. One afternoon, my father arrived unannounced and was not pleased to find her in the main room. He reproached my mother for her bad company and made her promise not to see her again. Ma, usually obedient to her husband, was unable to keep this promise. The rules of hospitality did not allow her to. Auntie Zakir had a strange habit. Every time she visited, she proposed a new marriage. "I'd take you for my nephew. He'll make you beautiful children and you'll want for nothing," she once told my eldest sister. "Hajjah, I'm 15. I'm a little young to get married." "Yes, but very soon you'll be old. So think fast, because he's old enough and he won't wait for you." Another day, it was to my uncle Ahmed, my mother's little brother, that she said, "If you want, I'll give you my niece. She's young and pretty. What's more, you'll be guaranteed a certificate of virginity." Uncle Ahmed agreed. One day, people told my mother that Aunt Zakir might have been Dad's mistress. "You see," replied my mother calmly, "my husband has many conquests, that's a fact. But why should he be interested in this woman who's married, Hajjah, older than him and, let's face it, not very pretty? Let me stop you right there. My husband will never look at that woman." The incident was over. But one lunchtime, as Abdulik and I entered Aunt Zakia's house, I noticed a strangely familiar plaid jacket in her vestibule. "Auntie Zakia, isn't that Daddy's jacket?" I asked. "That's my husband Jalal's jacket. They must have the same one, that's all. I don't think your husband could afford such a lovely jacket. Her husband worked for the commune." That evening at dinner, I asked my father, "Were you at Auntie Zakia's today?" "No," he replied without batting an eyelid. "In any case, your jacket was there." My mother's face turned white. At night, we heard them arguing. A few days later, Dad opened Aunt Zakia's door for us at lunchtime. He tried to get me to keep his secret. He promised me a dress and sunglasses, like Egyptian actresses, if I kept quiet. He also promised to break my jaw if I talked. I reported it to my sister, who passed it on to my mother, who immediately went to see Zakia's husband. "Impossible," he told her. "My wife is as ugly as a louse. Your husband is handsome and rich. He can do much better. Open your eyes. I'm telling you that my husband is taking your wife home. And you're telling me your wife is as ugly as a louse? You should hang yourself instead of spouting such nonsense." Everyone thought Zakir had bewitched my father. And then things accelerated. Screams, punches and kicks were a regular occurrence. My father beat my mother frequently. As if he didn't want her to exist anymore. As if he wanted us to disappear. Her body and face swollen in the throes of her 15th pregnancy, she wandered around the house enraged, exhausted. One day he came home and didn't speak. He just banged and banged. My mother didn't even scream anymore. She was like a rag doll in his hands. My grandfather jumped up and tried to intervene. He shouted, "Stop this! You're possessed!" We too tried to fight his blind hatred, to block it with our bodies. We shouted, desperate and terrified. Then Dad went away again, just like that. Ma was bathed in a great pool of blood. Big black clots were coming out from between her thighs. Ma was hospitalized for several days. I prayed she wouldn't die. Dad reappeared. He groaned, he didn't understand what had come over him. He was sorry. Ma would come home from the hospital with a baby. Very cute for sure. Dad, I didn't recognize him anymore. Ma lost twins 6 months into her pregnancy. And Dad did it again. One evening, on the way home from school, my father strangled my mother with a chesh. My brothers and sisters tried to separate them. But Dad held firm. He bellowed, "Today I kill you. Today is your day." My mother was no longer conscious. My father continued to squeeze. Grandpa rushed to our house. He said to me, "Crawl between his legs and bite his hand." Dad let go of Ma and ran off. He never came home again. Later, we learned that Auntie Zakir had sent her husband to pick olives on her land. When he returned, the house was empty. Not a piece of furniture left. Dad and Auntie Zakir had hired a truck to take everything away. My mother took me to court for the divorce decree. That's when I realized that all the love I'd felt for him had turned to hate. My mother said, "Judge, this woman took my husband away from me and left me with 7 children. Auntie Zakia's husband said, "Judge, this man took my wife and son and gutted my house." The judge looked weary and said, "I'm not going to take them home by force, so why don't you tell us what your requests are and get it over with?" Alimony has been fixed. My father only paid her if the bailiffs intervened. My eldest brother had to leave for military service. There were no men left at home. In our family, women don't work. A matter of honor. Especially as we had a reputation for being well-to-do. So my mother used to say, "God will provide for us." In the meantime, she sold her gold and spent what little savings she had left. My maternal uncles helped as best they could, but our situation was deteriorating. Ma didn't want to show anything, but the furniture in the house was disappearing one by one. We had to leave school. Abdulik was sent to train as a mechanic, and I was sent home. I must have been about 11 or 12. And then, as the years went by, things began to stabilize. Baya was married. Her husband, Milud, always present, always pleasant, also supported us. Yusef came back and started working. We were already living better. My mother was even able to travel to Mecca, thanks to her brothers. It was her dearest wish. I was 17 at the time. When the pilgrims returned, as we didn't live far from the airport and plane delays were long, family members came to wait for their loved ones at our place. I had to take care of all these people by preparing food for them. According to my brother Yusef's wishes, who loved to entertain, the meal had to be a small feast. Among our guests was one of my mother's cousins. He was waiting for his father. He was an educated man who had studied in Saudi Arabia. He wore a beautiful suit and shoes so shined you could see yourself in them. He was 27 and his name was Murad. Chapter 3. Murad. We ended up seeing him more and more often at home. Until one day, he asked me to marry him. He wasn't a bad guy. But I wasn't attracted to him at all. His slicked back head to straighten his frizzy hair and his superior airs annoyed me. I refused. He didn't like my answer at all. He swore at me, his face contorted with contempt and hatred. I'll marry you whether you like it or not. My elder sister arrived that evening with her husband. Yusef, Abdulik, and my mother were also there. We couldn't understand why I refused such a good match. Ma exclaimed that she wouldn't dare look into the eyes of Murad's mother, one of the family members for whom she had the most respect. My sister said I'd never get another chance like this. I shouted that he wasn't to my liking. You think you're in Switzerland telling us that? If someone tells you to marry him, you marry him and don't argue. Yusef told me. Only Abdulik defended me. But if she doesn't want to get married, we can't force her. Start by working. How do you like a house full of girls? She's getting married because we've decided. The others will follow and there won't be a girl left. Off you go. Abdulik, my ally, had run out of arguments against the marriage. I couldn't blame him, he wasn't in a strong position. Annoyed, I bowed to their will. The two families met at our house. All my mother's conditions regarding the dowry were accepted. My uncle, Happy, joined me in the bedroom and kissed me to congratulate me. I fainted. I wanted to die. But suicide is forbidden in our religion. Besides, I would have hurt Ma too much. Some time later, I had to go to my father's house to ask for a marriage license since I was still a minor. I hoped he would take the opportunity to ask me if I was all right and, above all, if I was willing. But he just mumbled. And what's more, she's found you a husband in her family. He refused because he didn't care about us anymore. I was furious. Everything you've done to Ma, everything you've done to us, I'll make you regret later when I'm older. I promise. The judge agreed that Yusef could give his consent in his place. The wedding took place in 1985. On the wedding night, Murad exclaimed, "If you're not a virgin, I'll send you back to your mother." This sentence stabbed me in the heart and made my blood run cold. We had provided her family with two certificates of virginity. The first, at the time of the engagement. The second, after a visit to the gynecologist the day before. And that wasn't enough. He had married me against my will when I was a minor and threatened to send me away if I didn't prove I was a virgin. How could I love him? A few days later, as I was breaking in a makeup bag given to me by my sister, he announced the color of our common future: no makeup, waxing, hairdressing, outings or visits. No Western TV either. Everything was haram. Forbidden by our religion. He was also jealous. Even of his nephew, who must have been 16, he forbade me to speak to him. A man, whether my brother or brother-in-law, could only visit me in his presence. After each of his visits to his mother's house, he would return aggressive and suspicious. I had no choice but to forbid the women in my family access to the house if he wasn't there. I took it upon myself to convince myself that this was my destiny. Despite this, he criticized me all the time. The dishes I cooked were either too salty or not salty enough. The furniture wasn't in the right place. His uniform was badly ironed. One day, I exploded. Your uniform, you can bring my mother, your mother, my sister, my brother, whoever you want, this is the last time I'll iron it. Go up to heaven and come down next time and iron it yourself. The arguments were incessant, and her mother was always getting in the way. This woman, who looked like a marabout, dressed all in white, respected by the whole family, the neighbors and everyone who came across her, was my worst nightmare. I was soon overcome by nausea. I thought it was the effect Murad was having on me, the physical and moral exhaustion. But it turned out I was pregnant. His mother practically moved in with us. She spied on my every move, belittled me and insulted me. Living with them became insurmountable. And as my pregnancy progressed, it turned out to be a real illness, with endless vomiting and dizziness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.